places, and they kept getting bigger and bigger. And I don't have a lot from one of these places. And you could tell that the original building was still there. It was a bit fancy, you know, Victorian. But when the passing of the typewriter came, then the auto industry became the thing. And the auto industry started taking over these factories, and they started building and expanding. And they were taking entire city blocks at a time. And then they would take a city block, and then they would build on the next city block. It would be right in the middle of town, literally. Anybody knows Woodstock, kind of like right in the middle of town. And so I was a half a block, just like a whole lot of other people were around this factory. But they didn't stay quite in queue and cleaned up. In fact, some of the images you see, that's Deborah probably ever looked at that nice. And it would just be this wall of glass window panes, the way the factories used to look. Some of them, you know, they've been repaired over and over again with different kinds of glass. They were broken, and it would just be like this sprawl. But that wasn't what was really bad, I think. And I was raising it, so it didn't seem abnormal to me. But it would be these smells all over the place. And you can like almost set your calendar by the smell of the week, because you kind of knew that this smell was coming. This is the acidic smell day. It's coming. And this is that weird smell that no one knows what it is. And the smoke clouds would billow out of those chimneys, and they'd be different colors. And the noise that would come out of that factory was amazing. And back then, you always knew what time it was, because all the shift whistles were always going off. Anybody live in that environment before where you just knew everything, you knew what was going on, because the factory kind of set the tone. It was so bad in the smell department, as a little boy, I mastered being able to hold my breath for 3 minutes while walking, because I didn't want to smell whatever was going on in this place. As time went on, the place became so polluted that it couldn't operate anymore. And the company that owned these several square blocks walked away. It was like, we're done. We can't do anything with this. And the city of Woodstock was left with, what are we going to do with this thing? It's all contaminated. We can't do anything with it. Even if we tear it down, it's going to have to take all this time before we can rebuild it, because it's got to be purified, on and on. And Woodstock finally did that. They tore it down. Leveled it. And they started the purification process, you know, and it just went on. And there was rumors that even after they tore it down, that you could hold a fluorescent light bulb over it and it would light up. I'm pretty sure that's not true, but it was a really prevalent rumor that was going on. All that to say, to ask a question, what does God think about the environment? What does God think about it? Now, I'm going to just tell you, I wrestled last year when I was building this calendar and looking at the theology of God, and I did not want to do today's message because most people already have an opinion of the environment. Am I kind of right on that? Raise your hand if you kind of already know where you stand. Okay. So I'm just like, I'm not going to tackle this one. So I would take it off, and I'm like, no, I got to do it. And I tried at four different times, I went back and forth. Am I going to deal with this issue? And at the end of the day, I'm like, God has a strong opinion on the environment, so I would like to go ahead and open up what that means. So can I ask a favor, like the hugest favor probably ever? You are ignoring me. Whatever your political viewpoint is, could you just relax? And go like this. Put your hands up, yeah, and breathe. Okay, and now, here's the hardest part. Flip those hands over and like I release whatever I once thought. Only for an hour. I might go back and revisit it and play it back. But for right now, I just really want to hear what God has to say about the environment. And I make you feel, I am not trying to sway you politically, okay? That's, I don't care. I don't care about politics. Anybody know me politically? Do I care? I don't care. I don't care at all. I care passionately about God, what God cares about. And so today's, we're going to talk about the theology of the environment. Fair enough? And everybody release. You go back to where you were an hour from now. I'm going to get you out early if you cooperate. Interesting thing about the Bible. The first chapter begins with perfect man in a perfect earth. first thing you see when you open the Bible, you see perfect man, perfect earth. Now, we talk about this formally. In any kind of school of thought, any kind of doing study, you always consider the rule of first occurrence. Does everybody know what I'm talking about? When you're studying any field, you look, when is the first time this subject was ever brought up? And then we watch how it morphed, but then we look at the rule of last occurrence. What is the summation? What is the current opinion? What is the current findings of everything that we've seen? So first occurrence and last occurrence are important. And so anybody know what the last chapter of the Bible talks about? A new person. A restored and perfect. In fact, a lot of times we miss this. We think that we're all going to go to heaven and that we're going to play harps on clouds. But Revelation tells us we're going to be on a renewed earth and we will be renewed people. So you see, the front of the Bible is starting out with a perfect earth, perfect man. And God does it. What does he say? He says he creates in Genesis 1:31. God saw all that he had made, and it was good. It was very good. And as we've been looking at the Backyard Theology series, man falls. Man goes his own way. Man suffers, and creation suffers all at the same time. But in Revelations, God restores man, and God restores the earth. This is important stuff. If the beginning and the end of the scriptures are talking about perfect man, perfect earth, and then a restored man and a restored earth at the end, it means something. And now, even in the fallen state in which we find this planet, you know, ravaged by nature, ravaged by storms and tsunamis and meteorites, and even what man has done against it, you still see the beauty God's creation. Remember we talked about no matter how marred we might be in God's sight, we still bear the image of God. Does everyone remember that? No matter how far gone you veered away from God, you still bear the image of God inside of you. You can't run away from it. It's in you. The image of God is stronger and bigger than any sin can ever be because God's creation is always greater than anything else, right? Yeah. And the same thing in the earth. The earth can be ravaged, be messed around with, it can be just like wrecked, but it still bears the mark of God. It just does. And God still cares about his creation. All of it. You and the earth. Genesis 2:15 records, or let me start with Genesis 1:25, records a creation story. God creates man and woman. And it says, God blessed them, and he said to them, fruitful and increase in number. So first of all, he says, go, procreate, have fun. It's going to be a ball. Then he said, fill the earth and subdue it. Subdue it. He says, you're supposed to do something with this earth. Subdue it. And he says, rule over it. Rule over the fish of the sea, and the birds of the air, and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Genesis 2:15 in like ways, it says, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to do what? To work it, and can we say it together? To take care of it. This is big. This, God gives the creation as a gift. It's variety, it's beautiful, it's an indication of who God is and his greatness, his majesty, and he gives it to us as a gift. But he also gives us one other thing, and it's the first law, the first commandment, before all laws and commands were ever made. Take care of it. Rule, subdue, enjoy, right? Does everybody catch that? Actually, this wouldn't even be called a command or a law. This is a mandate. Like, if you don't know what your purpose at all in life is, let's say that you're that unique person, God has no purpose for you at all. Doesn't exist. But let's just say, you know that the first thing that you're created to do is to care for the environment. Is that fair enough? So Adam names all the animals right off the bat, and that's interesting because you would think, why has God a name? I mean, the animal's an animal, why does he have a name? Because that's part of subduing, that's part of caring, that's That's this intimacy to actually know the creation at a deeper level. And I think it was deeper than the guy who has to name everything at IKEA, you know? Because the guy at IKEA, just I think he just has like a word scramble, and then he's a small cup, you know? No, I think it's a shelf. No, it's a small cup. No, but Adam goes into it and he goes, kind of controlled intimacy that Adam has. And so as time goes on, the psalmist enjoys creation. So that we see creation extolled all the time. But we're going to go to the book of Psalms, and Psalm 8, 3 through 9 talks about God's greatness of his creation, but it also talks about our position in relationship with the earth. He says, "When I consider your heavens, God, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you take care of him? You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor." Can we read verse 6 together? "You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet." Can we say that together? You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet. That's kind of read that. Take it in. All the flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The psalmist gets it. The psalmist sees how beautiful it is. He sees how grand it is. But he also sees our position over it. Not only just to enjoy it and to marvel over it, but to actually take care of it. Here's the thing. It is so tempting as we live in nature all the time that we take it for granted, right? And we feel entitled. We not maybe articulate say, I feel entitled, but we do feel entitled. I remember when I was in my mid-30s, and I was just a busy, busy guy, and someone would say, "Wasn't the sunset absolutely beautiful last night?" And I'm just like, who gives a flip? There's at least one of those every single day. I ain't got time for that. Anybody ever been there? Yeah. And then I start looking, and like, now I'll hesitate. Sometimes I'll be in the middle of a conversation, I'll just be like, oh, I ain't got time for you right now. This is absolutely spectacular. But that spirit of entitlement can grip us if we overlook it. When he says, "You made him ruler over the works of your hands," the word for ruler in the original Hebrew says a lot more than ruler. Are you ready? It is mashal. Mashal. It means, yes, to rule. It means to reign. It means to manage. That one's very impactful. It means to take care of. It's really a term of stewardship. This has been given from God to us to rule, to manage, to take care of. It's stewardship. Not exploit. Not take for granted. Not that I'm entitled to it. So, am I to become an environmentalist wacko? Am I to go ahead and be a tree hunter? Is that what I'm supposed to do? Should I be worshiping Mother Earth as much as I worship Father God? No. But just because some do does not give me a right to abandon the environment. Are you with me? I'm still not talking political. I know it's for some reason our political temperature kind of takes ownership of this. That's not what I'm talking about. But just because some people go overboard doesn't mean I have to toss the environment aside. I want to save this planet because it's the only one that has chocolate that we're aware of, right? And so we're all getting behind that, right? But we don't abandon people for chocolate. Hang in there. The overboard antics of environmentalist wackos and what they would value, the red-backed frog or whatever over human beings, that caused me to ditch and say, you know what? This is God's earth and he's going to take care of it. And that's it. You know, furniture, it comes from trees. That's all trees are good for, you know, or for paper and announcements. You know, that's what trees are for. Animals are just to eat, you know, and to consume. That's it. That's what God gave that stuff to me. Nothing more. It was that spirit of entitlement that gripped me. And it kind of was wrecking me. Because of other people going way over there, I was going to be all the way over here. I didn't treasure what God treasured the way that He did. When I was 9 years old, I got a sweater for my birthday. Guess what that sweater meant? Anybody? I don't know. It's a stupid sweater. What did I care? I was 9 years old. But that same birthday, I got basketball. And I always knew where that baby was. And even one time, I risked my life to save it when it got lost. We need to value what God has given us and take the responsibility that He has given us and take. We need to put our hands up this way and we can start to live with views and all that. Yet. So, when the church seems apathetic towards the environment, it communicates, I think, to God, but it also communicates to the world that we don't care and value what God cares and values about. Francis Schaeffer, 1970, wrote this. And Francis Schaeffer was no flaming liberal by any stretch of the imagination. Can we agree on that? Some people might be a little Francis Schaeffer, so Google it and get back to me. If I'm going to be right, or if I'm going to be in the right relationship with God, I should treat the things He has made in the same way He treats them. And he wrote that in 1970 in Pollution and the Death of Man. I honestly don't want to be political. And I don't want to be an environmentalist wacko. I don't want to be a zealous. I just want to love God. And I want to love what He loves and do and take care of the way that He wants me to take care of it, right? At the end of the day, and if that includes taking care of the earth, then that's what it means for me. I'm not entitled to all this beauty, all this variety. This is a gift that comes with the responsibility to take care of it. And just because I like the environment does not mean that I think the baby seals are more important than babies, right? And does it, is everybody clear that tree huggers don't actually hug trees? I mean, most of them actually don't. Some do, you know, some do. But I'm not going to be pigeonholed into non-action because someone calls me a name. I'm going to take care of what God has called me to take care of. This is important because we're all in this together. And maybe our part of the earth has it going on. We've got enough water. We're fine. That doesn't mean we should just, like, waste it all. Maybe there's a way to get it on the other side of the planet. Is there a way, you know, there's many ministries and missions that are going out there and taking care of that issue, and we of all people should be about that. But it's not only just our current population. What about the next generation? We are called to preserve this planet for the next generation. Psalm 115:15. Again, you might be saying, that's God's responsibility. God will take care of it for the next generation. May you be blessed by the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The highest heavens belong to the Lord. What belongs to the Lord? But the earth He has given to man. What do you think? That ain't me talking. That ain't some left-wing environmentalist wacko talking. This is the Bible. So what do we do with this gift? Trash shouldn't line our highways. Does anyone remember the 70s and 80s? Wasn't it just unbelievable? And I'll have a piece of paper in my hand and just eat a little piece. Sometimes it's even just a piece of cellophane. And I'm so tempted just to let it slip out the window. Yeah? And the only thing that stops me anymore is God's word. It's not the crying Indian from the 70s highlight. He was affected, but now it's gone. Now it's gone. Yeah. We should have a picture of that, Charlie. Animals should not become extinct. That's not good to Sean. That's not good management. That's terrible. We do need to be conscious of God's creation and preserving that. Man, we're in the breadbasket, so this is really hard to say. Consuming is not man's role. You follow the instruction, you just get it. I'm just here to consume. And I have more stuff. God's just given us so much stuff. It's not our role. That's entitlement. We should be careful to conserve and not waste. Even Jesus, the miracle of the fishes and loaves. Everybody remember that account where he like take a little and turn it into so much that there was leftovers, right? And what happened at the very end of that account? Jesus says, gather the pieces that are left over, let nothing be wasted. The principle is let sin. It's like, but Jesus, none of that stuff existed before. All of a sudden, it just puffed out of nowhere. Can't we just waste that? It's no big deal. Like, no. Let anything be wasted. Clear cutting. And again, it touches into political, but please, let's get out of there. But clear cutting, without planning for the next generation and to replant just so we can have another strip mall today, there's something wrong with that. And it was a Republican, Teddy Roosevelt, who gave us our national park system and protected. Can you imagine if that hadn't happened and what the Grand Canyon would look like today, peppered with cliff houses and resorts and everything. But now you can go there and it's beautiful, it's a great preserve. And what would New York City be like? You know how much I love New York City? But part of what makes me love New York City is if you go to Central Park and get a breath from all that. We have to be careful about the next generations because some of the generations that went before us were careful for us. Amen?
Amen.
All right. How's everybody feeling?
Great.
Really? Are we really feeling good?
No, I'm not.
Who's got that tension or anxiety level right now? Just raise your hand. Okay, there's one, two, three, okay. Can I go someplace that no one's gonna want to go? Climate change. Did I hear a bunch of grumbles and scary things? Climate change. Something seems to be happening. There are like big record amounts of ice melting in different areas. The storms have become really bizarre. I mean, watching the Weather Channel this year as opposed to a decade ago is different. Am I right? They got double tornadoes as a regular thing now, you know? I mean, oh my gosh, you know, hurricane seasons are off the hook. Temperatures are weird. Do I need to say anything about the last winter? There's something happening. And then on top of it, you got the South Pole that's actually putting it on ice, you know? It's like, what is going on here? And so I think the first thing we have to at least agree with is that there is something going on. There's something going on. There was a letter to the editor written in a Christian magazine. And he says it this way. He goes, scientists are divided over it. But the liberal media treats it like it's a fact. Al Gore was not around during the Ice Age. The Earth has gone through several warming and cooling periods, all according to God's plan, not man's. Think about that. He says scientists are divided. That's a fact. Okay? The media knows this is true. That's pretty much a fact. And then he says, Al Gore was not around during the Ice Age. He may have done. He's getting kind of old. He wasn't. Now listen to his conclusion. The Earth has gone through several warming and cooling periods, all according to God's plan, not man's. He knows that's true. Can he know that that's true? Let's just be honest. He can't know that's true. That's a nice belief that he has. He knows that Al Gore wasn't there, but somehow he was there. Are you with me? I hope you can stay with me because I'm not political right now. I'm really not. He doesn't know. Al Gore doesn't know. Nobody knows what the cause is or what is going on. Nobody even knows it's part of God's cycle. Nobody knows. We all have our opinions and our feelings, but we don't. Is what we're going through natural? Is it from God? Maybe God's getting us ready for something. I don't know. Is it man? Are we the problem? We don't know. So can we stop arguing about it with our friends and neighbors and family members as if we do know? Let that just kind of sit. Has anybody in your heated argument ever come around to your way of thinking on this topic? Anybody? Have you had that radical turn of like, I never saw it that way before. You're exactly right. We don't know. We weren't there. And so this is where faith enters. When we start arguing with people about things that we don't know and are not essential, we require them to agree with us on a topic before we can introduce them to Jesus. Are you with me? We put this litmus test on and say, I think this way. And the other person is like, well, I think this way. Well, then you never can get around to the issues of faith, and you can never build conversation. It's like the Christians allow the environment to be taken away from them by a political party or by secular groups. And we argue about who did it instead of what can we do to mishal this earth? What can we do to rule it, to subdue it, to take care of it, to manage it? That's where our conversation needs to be. I believe the scriptures spell out. Because it is not just God's thing. God gave it to us to manage, to mishal. How's everybody doing now? Okay, a little anxiety, but that's okay. This climate change talk should not threaten you as a Christian. It shouldn't give you anxiety. It shouldn't get you tense. Because if it does, there's something off. And I pray that you just listen to the Spirit about what that would be. This kind of talk should motivate us to want to take care of our planet. It should cause us to engage in conversation with people. What can we do? Instead of bridge burning, we should be bridge building. Because what's going on is maybe you're talking with an unbeliever and you're tapping into, you're like, you're a little bit overboard on this taking care of the planet thing. Well, that's because the mandate is still in them from when they were created. You get what I'm saying? This is a trace of what is left in them from who God has created them to be. Don't crush it. Bring it to life. And then what happens is you might surprise them. And they're like, they lean into you a little bit more. And they're like, you can talk about this without preaching to me? I like that. I like your faith. Can you tell me more about your faith? And then they ultimately find Jesus. Because we didn't have this gate that said, I want you to preempt the environment before we go any further in a relationship. Are you with me? Can you see why I didn't want to read this message? I do not want to do this one. Can we at least agree having conversation is a good thing? And that your conversations with your neighbor who doesn't agree with you or your in-law will go a lot easier? At least that. That factory in Woodstock, they did tear it down and it took them a long time, you know, to let it get clean. They picked it out. And now it's nice. Clean condominiums with green space. And the kids these days in that neighborhood don't have to hold their breath for 3 minutes because of everything that's going at them. And there is a place where we can restore and take care of this earth in healthy, unwackled ways. So I'd just like you to consider, how can you personally mishal the earth without joining Greenpeace? First thing, so practical. Could you just get outside and enjoy God's nature? Could you just do like the Psalms, how majestic is your name? Look at the stars, you hung in a place. You made me ruler over this, the mishal, to rule, to manage, to enjoy, to procreate. Let me be a good steward of that. Enjoy it. Number two, change your conversation. If you've got a strong opinion, why don't you submit that to God and we'll talk about what God has to say about it rather than what your favorite news station has to say about it, right? Chill it down. Let's bring it back to God and not about there? Do we know what's going on? I don't know what's going on. And maybe take some steps in your own house. You know, maybe you can change your light bulbs. You know, maybe you can change your thermostat so it's, you know, you're a little bit cooler or warmer, you know, to save some energy. You know, maybe you can use fans more than air conditioning. Maybe you just go out and start planting things. Let's have more flowers. Let's have more trees, you know. Let God's beauty be seen and enjoyed, because if they can see beauty, has anybody ever been to the Davis yard? Oh my gosh. Can you not think of God there? It's just, it's beautiful. Can I say the same thing that I always say? It's okay. This is going to get outside the walls and going to get out of context, but I don't care. Whatever. The Davis yard is what the world would look like if God had more money. But that's the good. Don't repeat it outside the walls. It won't get the context of it. But you can do that, because this is God's beauty. I remember when we went over to the trailer park over in Elkhorn, and it was just like, ugh. And we started planting flowers all over the place, and that place came to life. They started seeing God, started coming to Christ. It all started with nature. Make it easier for people to see God in the creation. Something looks junky around you. Maybe you need to adopt a highway, you know, adopt a park that isn't being taken care of. And then practically, why do we have to go? You know, you and I are probably going to see the same movie next month. Why don't we go and do it together? You know, now that we save some gas, we'll get community on the way there. Why don't we run a DVD and do that together? Let's do more cookouts together. Instead of this family unit building, you know, their whole meal, then this way. Why don't we just get together and take care of this stuff together? And a lot of people, you won't go to Sam's Club or Gordon's Food Services because you can't eat a number 10 can of corn. But go with another family, and now all of a sudden you get to eat cheap, you save gas on the way there, and you make friends by doing it, right? And then does it get any more practical than that? Is there any Goodwill Salvation Army fans around here? Yeah. The ultimate in recycling is right there. It's all recycled, and you're helping the community. You don't have to be an environmentalist wacko to take care of God's good first. I'll leave you with this. My daughter and I would play Dr. Mario and Mario Brothers and Nintendo, and we had a blast. But we don't have any pictures of that. And we don't really talk about those five memories. But that was Door County when she was around 12 years old, and that's her Facebook profile picture, because it's deep and it's meaningful. Your kids and your grandkids will remember things done in God's beauty, nature, beaches, far more than any film or game you've ever played. May you be blessed by the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth is given to you. Let's continue to worship God by giving your tithes and offerings. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you give us the earth to take care of. Beautiful earth. Thank you for that responsibility. Thank you for the reminder. And you give us a big, beautiful church. But you tell us to take care of it. You provide for that. I am giving our tithes and offerings. I pray that you would bless this offering. We would be very careful stewards with it, so that we build your kingdom. I pray that you would bless the giver.
change your plan from the skip to the last song of the day, Sean? Would you guys stand up? And hearing the message. I don't know if it's from God or if it's just an idea I had. The Bible says how people can see that God exists by looking at the heavens and by creation. I mean, who are we if we besmirch that which speaks of our God? If we treat it. I think you guys know what I'm saying. My mouth isn't working, but speaking words of God. We wouldn't just go up to Dale before the message and try to cover his mouth, so why would we let nature not do
I
mean, she wasn't. All right. Next week, don't come back here. Go to Veterans Park in the bottom of the hill where they shoot fireworks off. And at 10 a.m., we will be having our annual picnic. So please go there. And for those of you who have taken a significant step towards Christ, but you haven't marked it by baptism yet, you haven't made that decision, or maybe your parents did way back when, but you've had a significant step towards Christ, it's time to mark that by baptism. On July 27th, next Sunday at 9 a.m., please come for a 20-minute tutorial so you discover what it is and what you can expect, and then mark your calendar also. Here's a date of, I need help, August 20th, Wednesday in Lake Geneva, we will be baptized. We'll get details next Sunday at 9 a.m. It's our best service, bar none ever, so everybody be there. Let me close this with Psalm 115:15-16 as your benediction and blessing today. May you be blessed by the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth is given to you. God bless you. See you next Sunday.
way that they go. I'll get those up.
Because she's in that, like, for Emmy stage.
Yeah. Put that back up. Put it in the ring. I lost my husband. He was
beautiful today.
Last moment. Is it still recording? Is that why the lights are on?
Probably.